Good morning. Welcome to Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace. Welcome to the soul of Sunday. We are Unitarian Universalists. Ours is a historic faith with a progressive theology. We affirm the worth and dignity of every being, and that we are all deeply interconnected. We are bound to one another, not by creed, but by covenant. And we are called to answer the call of love with open minds, open hearts, and open hands. Whoever you are, those of all nations, all creeds, all colors, all kinds of love, you are welcome here. As we gather, we acknowledge that Arlington Street Church occupies the ancestral homeland of the Massachusetts. By making this land acknowledgement, we recognize, honor, and affirm the sovereignty of all First Nations peoples.
Just be.
Dear ones, welcome to our Zoomers and welcome to the congregation, the little congregation gathered here in the sanctuary and the giant congregation gathered in the Zoom room. It's cold outside. Thank you, friends, you're courageous. My New Englanders are all here. I want to say a very special thanks to our volunteers today, tech team lead Art Nava and his team, Kevin Terrell, Richard Brew, and Marie O'Brien in Chicago. Our Great Doors team, Queen Cheryl, Tom Anderson, and Bruce Dallaire. Our ushers, Bill Briggs and Keith Perrin. Worship team lead, Daryl Waters. And our musicians, Hyungju on piano and soprano, Hannah Shanefield, our one-woman heavenly host this morning. All of these people were here late last night to welcome our Christmas Eve guests. I'm deeply grateful for their service to our beloved spiritual community. Thank you, sweethearts. Following the guidance of the Boston Public Health Commission, we're continuing to mask and physically distance here in the sanctuary. Please keep your mask up over your nose and mouth the whole time you're inside to protect the most vulnerable among us. Thank you, friends. For those of you who are new to Arlington Street, a very special welcome to you. In the sanctuary, there are welcome cards in the pew racks. Please hand yours to an usher or to Queen Cheryl, or drop it in the basket at the great doors as you leave. For those of you in the Zoom room, please fill out a connection card. The link is in the chat. It includes the option to request the link to a recording of today's service. And since we can't greet all of you in person after the service, Reverend Beth and I would love to follow up with a virtual hello. Whether you've been coming here for years or today is your very first time at Arlington Street, welcome home.
Hello there. Merry Christmas. Zoomers, if you haven't already downloaded today's order of service, it's available in the chat and on the homepage at ascboston.org. As we begin our greetings, I invite all of us with a device handy to please say hello in the chat and tell us where you're zooming in from today. And now, Rich is going to turn the camera on the incarnate congregation as we wave and smize at each other as well as at our friends in the Zoom room. And you all in the Zoom room can wave and smile back. Hello, friends. Let's all engage that Arlington Street spirit of welcome that transcends physical distance as we greet one another heart to heart. Today, we mark fulfillment of Advent with this poem by Mark Strand, The Coming of Light. Even this late it happens, the coming of love, the coming of light. You wake, and the candles are lit as if by themselves. Stars gather, dreams pour into your pillows, sending up warm bouquets of air. Even this late, the bones of the body shine, and tomorrow's dust flares into breath.
Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher kidishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu lechalikna shel Chanukah Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam she'asa nisim lavoteinu bayamim chaham Lazman hazeh. Amen. A
Now I'd like to invite everybody to join in singing Ma'otsor, Rock of Ages, and rise in spirit, body, whatever you would like to rise in.
It is now time for our treasured ritual of sharing community candles of sorrow and joy. These candles were submitted on our website by the Friday evening deadline. If you didn't submit your candle and have a joy or sorrow to share this morning, please wait until the third candle is lit, the silent candle, and then type your joy or sorrow in the chat. Zoomers are invited to light silent candles at home. Those in the sanctuary are invited to light a silent candle at the table up front to the right of the Gleason podium. In addition to sharing our sorrows and joys this morning, let's reach out to one another in the week ahead, staying connected. May these times remind us of how very precious this beloved community is. We need one another. Whether together or apart, may we stay very close. And now, in this spirit of invocation, let's join in singing Sanctuary. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat.
We open our hearts to you.
A candle of sorrow from the Arlington Street Church community as we grieve at the devastating news that as of last week, university education in Afghanistan will be suspended for all women. This is just the latest in a series of decisions by the Taliban as they continue to strip away hard-fought freedoms that women had achieved over the past two decades. Earlier this year, secondary education was suspended for young women as well. And our final candle of sorrow is from Sarah Netsky, a candle of sorrow for my beloved Italian professor who passed last Friday. He left a mark on my life that I take with me every day. For those who know about my passion for all things Italian, you've also met him in your own right. Alfonso Procaccini, presente.
Presente. Some of us come today in joy. We share your joy.
From Lori Patrick, thank you for specifically welcoming gay men and women into Christmas Eve services. An inclusive, loving religion has a home here at this church. Thank you. And a mixed candle, a personal candle from me. A candle of gratitude for the entire Arlington Street Church community for your love and support during my recent bereavement. Your kindness was very much appreciated. I feel blessed to be a part of this beloved community. Thank you all. And special thanks to Reverend Beth, Reverend Kim, and Reverend Allie, whose care and concern have helped sustain me during this time.
True with
for all the sorrows and all the joys we hold in our hearts, we light a silent candle to remember and to rejoice. May the peace of this sanctuary enter into our hearts as we share a quiet moment together, breathing our prayers for ourselves, for one another, for our country, and for the world. Amen.
Let's join now in saying together the affirmation and covenant of this beloved spiritual community. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat. Love is the spirit of this congregation, and service is our gift. This is our great covenant,
to dwell together in peace, to speak our truths in love,
and to help one another.
El amor es el espíritu de nuestra congregación, y el servicio es nuestro regalo. Esto es a lo que nos comprometemos, convivir en paz, hablar nuestras verdades con amor y ayudarnos los unos a los otros.
Our next carol is carol 237, the first Noel. We invite you to join us, rise in body and spirit, and sing along.
Marley was dead. Old Marley was dead as a doornail. Scrooge never painted out old Marley's name, however, the firm was known as Scrooge and Marley. Oh, but he was a tight-fisted hand at the grindstone, was Scrooge. A squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner. No warmth could warm, no cold could chill him. Once upon a time, of all the good days in the year, upon a Christmas Eve, old Scrooge sat busy in his counting house. It was cold, bleak, biting, foggy weather, and the city clocks had only just gone three, but it was quite dark already. The door of Scrooge's counting house was open that he might keep his eye upon his clerk, Bob Cratchit, who in a dismal little cell beyond was copying letters. "A Merry Christmas, Uncle! God save you!" cried a cheerful voice. Scrooge's nephew was at the door. "Bah!" said Scrooge. "Humbug!" "Christmas a humbug, Uncle! You don't mean that, I'm sure." "I do. Out upon Merry Christmas. If I had my will, every idiot who goes about with Merry Christmas on his lips should be boiled with his own pudding and buried with a stake of holly through his heart. Much good it has ever done you." "Uncle, I am sure I have always thought of Christmas time, apart from the veneration due to its sacred origin, if anything belonging to it can be apart from that, as a good time, a kind, forgiving, charitable, pleasant time, the only time I know of in the long calendar of the year when people seem by one consent to open their shut-up hearts freely and to think of others as if they really were fellow travelers to the grave. I believe that Christmas has done me good and will do me good, and I say, God bless it! And dine with us tomorrow, Uncle." "Good afternoon," said Scrooge sharply, and his nephew left without an angry word, notwithstanding. Bob Cratchit, in letting Scrooge's nephew out, let two other people in. "At this festive season of the year, Mr. Scrooge," said a gentleman, "a few of us are endeavoring to raise a fund to buy the poor some meat and drink and means of warmth. We choose this time because it is a time of all others when want is keenly felt and abundance rejoices. What shall we put you down for?" "Nothing." At length, the hour of shutting up the counting house arrived. Scrooge walked out with a growl and went home. And there, having his key in the lock of the door, he saw in the knocker, not a knocker, but Marley's face, with a dismal light about it, like a bad lobster in a dark cellar. Then it was a knocker again. Unfazed, Scrooge fastened the door and went up, not carrying a button for its being very dark. Darkness is cheap, and Scrooge liked it. He took off his cravat, put on his dressing gown and slippers and his nightcap, and sat down before the very low fire to take his gruel. Suddenly, there was a clanking noise as if someone were dragging a heavy chain on the floors below, then coming up the stairs, then coming straight towards his door. It came on through the heavy door, and a specter passed into the room before his eyes. It was Marley, Marley's ghost. "How now?" said Scrooge, caustic and cold as ever. "What do you want with me?" "Much." Marley's voice, no doubt about it. "Mercy, dreadful apparition, why do you trouble me?" "Oh, ignorant man, not to know that any good person working kindly in his little sphere, whatever it may be, will find his mortal life too short for its vast means of usefulness. Not to know that no space of regret can make amends for one's life's opportunities missed.
But you were always a good man of business, Marley, faltered Scrooge, who was beginning to apply this to himself.
Business, cried the ghost, wringing its hands. Humankind was my business. The common welfare was my business. Charity, mercy, forbearance, benevolence were all my business. Hear me. I am here tonight to warn you that you have yet a chance and hope of escaping my fate. You will be haunted by three spirits. For your own sake, remember what has passed between us.
Let's rise in body, rise in spirit, and sing together Carol 246.
Scrooge is indeed haunted by three spirits. The first spirit is the ghost of Christmas past. This is for your welfare, he tells Scrooge. Rise and walk with me. Among many scenes, the ghost shows him the warehouse where Scrooge had apprenticed under kindly Mr. Fezziwig. On Christmas Eve, the shop is closed early, and the floor is cleared for music and dancing, games, and a great feast for the Fezziwig's family and staff, some 40 people in all. At the close of an enchanted evening, Mr. and Mrs. Fezziwig stand on either side of the door and shake hands with every guest, wishing them a Merry Christmas. A small matter, says the ghost, looking on, to make these folks so full of gratitude. Fezziwig has spent but a few pounds of your mortal money. Is that so much? It isn't that, says Scrooge. The happiness he gives is quite as great as if it costs a fortune. The ghost also shows him the sad scene in which Scrooge's betrothed breaks off their engagement. The young woman has realized that as miserly as Scrooge has become, he will only resent and regret a marriage to a girl without a dowry. "Another idol has displaced me," she tells him, "a golden one. You fear the world too much. I have seen your nobler aspirations fall off one by one until the master passion, gain, encompasses you." Scrooge is devastated to relive this memory. "Spirit, remove me from this place." The ghost of Christmas past leaves him to sink into a heavy sleep. The second spirit of the ghost is the ghost of Christmas present. Among many scenes, the ghost shows Scrooge Bob Cratchit's home. The Cratchits are very poor, though delighting each other, and especially in their youngest, Tiny Tim. Bob and Tiny Tim have just returned from church, where Tiny Tim says he hopes the people saw him because he is a cripple, and it might be pleasant for them to remember upon Christmas Day who made a lame beggar's walk and blind men see. They share a spare meal and invoke a blessing on everyone, including Ebenezer Scrooge. Scrooge asks the ghost of Christmas present if Tiny Tim will live. He replies, "If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die." The ghost also shows him his nephew's holiday party, where Scrooge's family is laughing, making music, and playing games. "He says that Christmas is a humbug," cries Scrooge's nephew. "He's a comical old fellow, that's the truth, and not so pleasant. However, his offenses carry their own punishment. Who suffers by his ill whims? Himself, always. Here, he won't come and dine with us. What's the consequence?" "He loses a very good dinner," answers Scrooge's niece. Uncle Scrooge has much to ponder in these scenes, but the ghost of Christmas present fades away, and there is a solemn phantom, draped and hooded, coming like a mist along the ground toward him, the last of the spirits. "Am I in the presence of the ghost of Christmas yet to come?" asks Scrooge. "Ghost of the future, I fear you more than any specter I have seen. But as I know your purpose is to do me good, and as I hope to live to be another man from what I was, I am prepared to bear you company and do it with a thankful heart. Will you not speak to me?" The ghost gave him no reply, but took him to the Cratchits' home. Tiny Tim is dead. They also visit a lonely, painful deathbed, though Scrooge cannot fathom that it is his. And finally, the ghost leads Scrooge to the graveyard, to a neglected grave with his name on the stone. "Am I that man who lay upon the bed? No, spirit. Oh, no, no. Spirit, hear me. I am not the man I was. Assure me that I yet may change these shadows you have shown me by an altered life. I will honor Christmas in my heart and try to keep it all the year. I will live in the past, the present, and the future. The spirits of all three shall strive within me. Oh, tell me that I might sponge away the writing on this stone."
Our next carol this morning, it's 231. The words can be found in the gray hymnal and in the chat. Let's rise in body, rise in spirit, and sing together, "Angels We Have Heard on High," carol 231.
singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains, Gloria, in ecstasy stirred.
The spirit fades away. Scrooge awakens in his bed. I will live in the past, the present, and the future, Scrooge repeats as he scrambles out of bed. The spirits of all three shall strive within me. To his great delight, he learns that it is indeed Christmas morning. Anonymously, he sends a turkey twice as big as Tiny Tim to the Cratchit family. He dresses in his finest clothes and walks out into the street, greeting everyone with a delighted smile. He looked so irresistibly pleasant that three or four good-humored fellows said, "Good morning, sir, a Merry Christmas to you." And Scrooge said afterwards that of all the blithe sounds that he had ever heard, those were the blithest ever in his ears. He had not gone far when, coming toward him, he beheld the men who had been collecting for the poor the day before. It sent a pang across his heart to think how these gentlemen would look upon him when they met, but he knew what path lay straight before him, and he took it. "My dear sir," said Scrooge, "I hope you succeeded yesterday. It was very kind of you. Merry Christmas to you, sirs." The gentleman's bewilderment gave way to astonishment as Scrooge leaned in to whisper, "My dear Mr. Scrooge, are you serious?" "If you please," said Scrooge, "not a farthing less. A great many back payments are included in it, I assure you. Will you do me that favor?" "We will," cried the gentleman. "Thank you," said Scrooge. "I am much obliged to you. I thank you 50 times. God bless you." In the afternoon, he turned his steps toward his nephew's house. He passed the door a dozen times before he had the courage to go up and knock. He was welcomed with open arms and enjoyed a wonderful party. The next morning, he was early at the office. "A Merry Christmas, Bob," said Scrooge, with an earnestness that could not be mistaken as he clapped Bob Cratchit on the back. "A merrier Christmas, Bob, my good fellow, than I have given you for many a year. I'll raise your salary and endeavor to assist your struggling family, and we will discuss your affairs this very afternoon over a Christmas bowl. Scrooge was better than his word. He did it all and infinitely more, and to Tiny Tim, who did not die young, he was a second father. He became as good a man as the good old city ever knew. Some people laughed to see the alteration in him, but his own heart laughed, and that was quite enough for him. He had no further interaction with spirits, but it was always said of him that he knew how to keep Christmas well. May that truly be said of us. And so, as Tiny Tim observed, God bless us, everyone.
Our next carol is number 240, I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day. The words can be found in the gray hymnal and in the chat. Let's rise in body, rise in spirit, and sing together carol 240, I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day.
There is no improving on Dickens. And so, my beloved spiritual companions, just this then, the heart of it all. To this Christmas morning, we bring the past, all that we have been. But here too begins the future, yours, mine and ours together. May we embrace and celebrate this precious gift we have been given and welcome Christmas as Christmas welcomes Scrooge to life. Together, let us unwrap this wonderful gift, the gift of Christmas present. May it be said of us that we too know how to keep Christmas well. God bless us, everyone. Amen.
Our next carol is number 239, Go Tell It on the Mountain. The words can be found in the gray hymnal and in the chat. Let's rise in body, rise in spirit, and sing together, Go Tell It on the Mountain. Arlington Street is entirely self-sustaining. It's up to us, and our generosity continues to be astounding. Thank you for your commitment to our staff, our building, and our beloved spiritual community. Each Sunday, we share our collection plate with a partner in our mission of love, service, justice, and peace. Today's gifts will go to Every Town, the largest gun violence prevention organization in the United States. Every Town lobbies for gun control legislation and also provides support services to survivors of gun violence. Thank you for your generosity. On this Christmas morning, I want to share with you Reverend Victoria Safford's The Moment of Magic. Now is the moment of magic, when the whole round earth turns again towards the sun. And here's a blessing. The days will be longer and brighter now, even before the winter settles in to chill us. Now is the moment of magic, when people beaten down and broken, with nothing left but misery and candles and their own clear voices, kindle tiny lights and whisper secret music. And here's a blessing. The dark universe is suddenly illuminated by the lights of the menorah, suddenly ablaze with the lights of the kinara, and the whole world is glad and loud with winter singing. Now is the moment of magic, when an eastern star beckons the ignorant toward an unknown goal. And here's a blessing. They find nothing in the end but an ordinary baby, born at midnight, born in poverty, and the baby's cry, like bells ringing, makes people wonder, as they wander through their lives, what human love might really look like, sound like, feel like. Now is the moment of magic, and here's a blessing. We already possess all the gifts we need. We've already received our presence, ears to hear music, eyes to behold lights, hands to build true peace on earth, and to hold each other tight in love. Please take a moment now to join me in giving to our beloved spiritual community and filling our virtual collection plate. You can order online, you can give online by scanning the QR code in the order of service or by going to ascboston.org. You can mail a check to the church or use the envelopes in the pews, which can be handed to Reverend Kim or me or to any of our ushers after the service. You can also text or Venmo at Arlington Street. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you. Thank you, young Jew. If you'd like to get more involved at Arlington Street beyond Sunday mornings, you are warmly invited to gather in the Zoom room throughout the week for loving kindness meditation, poetry, yoga, and writing. On Tuesday evening, it's Buddha's Belly Book Group and the Arlington Street Meditation Center. On Wednesday, and every Wednesday at 4, Reverend Kim and Reverend Beth host a tea party with a conversation prompt. For the close of the year, this week's prompt is, tell us about something at which you look back and think, I can't believe I did that. Information and Zoom room links are at ascboston.org. To attend any of these gatherings, you don't have to be a member, you don't have to turn on your video if you don't want to, and they're all free. All are always welcome. Following today's service, everyone is welcome to join the virtual coffee hour. If you'd like to participate, please answer yes to the breakout room invitation that will appear on your screen. But if you're here in the sanctuary, now is a good time to start making your way to the Zoom room. And then if you're here in person, please consider staying for the Queen's Christmas, sharing confections, coffee, and one another's good company. Thanks to all of you who joined in today's service, and to all those who made it possible. Remember, we're all in this together. I love you. Our last carol this morning is Joy to the World. The words can be found in the gray hymnal and in the chat. Let's rise in body, rise in spirit, and sing together Joy to the World.
Before our benediction, I invite those of you in the Zoom room to please reach out your hands and touch the sides of your square. And those of you in the sanctuary to please raise your hands, palms out. Let's send loving kindness to the people on your left and your right. Send loving kindness to the person on either side of you and to the people on either side of them. Send out love into this beloved spiritual community. And feel it coming back to you. Love is the spirit of this congregation. And now for our benediction, I invite you to put your hands over your heart and namaste. I bow to the divine in you. From British American poet W.H. Auden. And now let Christmas overtake us in all our haste and unpreparedness. And renew the miracle of love once again in our hearts. Let us keep this faith, beloveds, and pass it on. The service begins when the service ends. Bless your hearts. I love you. Merry Christmas. Amen.
wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Good tidings we bring wherever you are. Good tidings for Christmas and a Happy New Year. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New
Please visit ascboston.org for more information about this historic Unitarian Universalist congregation. Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace.